alien creatures, huge, mysterious things that hang suspended in a liquid medium, yet must continuously rise to suck in the gaseous atmosphere above them. Creatures that see with sound waves, with brains many times the size of man's. Creatures that possess an intricate and eerie communication system. These are whales, the largest animals ever to inhabit the earth, bigger than dinosaurs, some with tongues larger than a bull elephant. These mysterious behemoths are mammals, warm-blooded animals in the same family as man. Their ancestors lived on land, and the skeletons of whales still contain fingers and other vestigial traces of their land-based heritage. There are many kinds of whales. They can be found in every ocean of the world. But until very recently, whales have been massively harvested as huge fleshy resources for man's consumption. But as we begin to penetrate the thin skin of the surface of the ocean, the mystery of these magnificent animals has captured our imagination, and a worldwide effort has mounted to protect these fascinating creatures, which are so closely related to man, yet so awesomely different. Alaskan waters are the home of many kinds of whales, especially during summer, when the nutrient-rich northern waters bloom into an opulent feasting grounds to feed the voracious whales. The North Pacific humpback whale is seen in the waters of southeast Alaska and Prince William Sound in the summer, and in the warm waters off the coasts of Mexico and Hawaii, where this film was taken in the winter. Humpbacks are a medium-sized baleen whale, 40 to 50 feet long, and they weigh 30 to 40 tons. They were harvested nearly to extinction. Alaskan waters once had an estimated 4 to 6,000 humpbacks. 60 have been counted in recent years. Humpbacks have gained fame recently as the most vocal of all the whales. They spend much of their time near land, and they become the object of intense study. Yet there is still very little known about the humpback whale. Alaska Review traveled with researcher Sharon Guinn and a party of people aboard the 73-foot sailboat Windigo last summer in Glacier Bay. It was a cruise sponsored by Oceanic Expeditions to do research on the humpback, and paid for by people who wished to devote their summer vacations in search of the whale.
Our primary purpose is to find out something about how many humpback whales there are and where they spend their time and what they do there. It sounds basic, but we're gonna have to start from where we're at, start from the beginning.
What you want to listen for is anything that sounds like a clicking noise, or anything that sounds like a whistle, or something like a door creaking, guitar strings breaking, babies crying, goats bleeding. They really do sound like that. Sometimes they sound like chickens, too.
Humpbacks can eat several tons a day of food. Shrimp, herring, candlefish, krill, apparently almost anything it can find in enough quantity that it can sift through its gaping maw of baleen.
The reason why we're doing plankton toes is to find out what kind of biomass is available for whales to eat in the way of food. And a plankton net, we're using both a phytoplankton net and a zooplankton net. So we're trying to get an idea of what's available and how many whales it might be supporting. Almost to the surface, a couple feet. Quit with the winch there. Thank you. There's at least one euphausid shrimp, anyway. Euphausids are one of the things. They're a small shrimp, maybe about 5 to 10 millimeters here, or a little bit over. And they're one of the things that we think the humpbacks are feeding on in Glacier Bay, anyway.
bubble net feeding is one of the modes of feeding that the humpback whale uses, and it's the only whale we've seen that appears to do this, and it only occurs in certain places as far as we know. And those places include Glacier Bay and other parts of southeast Alaska. What the whale does is to make a circle underwater, blowing bubbles as it's making a circle. And and then after making that circle, you can see the bubbles rising to the surface. So they are making a curtain of fine bubbles in a circle, which presumably acts as a net around a school of herring or capelin. And as a herding mechanism for the whales, because the whale then comes up in the middle of that circle with its mouth open and is able to gather up a large portion of that, whatever's inside the net, and then shuts its mouth and strains the water out.
Charles Juracz, a high school biology teacher from Juneau, has spent much of the last 12 summers tracking whales in southeast Alaska. He noted the whale's technique of bubble net feeding, and he's concerned about the future of this endangered whale.
What we see now is that this area around Glacier Bay is rapidly declining in terms of its population, and we feel that relates to the vessel traffic. We see certainly that the area here in Auk Bay has dropped significantly. That we attribute to a combination of vessel traffic and the taking of the herring. When an animal reaches that state, that low number condition, that people say, all right, this animal is endangered, we have to start examining several characteristics that support this animal, and certainly one of them is habitat, and we end up defining it as critical habitat which is absolutely necessary to the animal. It has only been recently that we've had enough understanding, enough measurement, so that we can say, well, these are the things that must not go on from here. The concern is certainly that it might be too late. If not in southeast, then certainly it might be too late for some areas like Auk Bay or for Glacier Bay. Are we really in a position in this day and age where we say we can afford to protect a species? In some cases, we've opted to say we can destroy a species if it's in our national interest. And in other cases, I think what we're saying is we better examine whether or not this is national interest at this point, whether we are really at a crisis stage in terms of the protection of our nation, or whether we're at a crisis stage in terms of protection of the species.
Even though we're no longer killing the humpback, man's insatiable curiosity is becoming a threat to the whale, so much so that the National Marine Fisheries Service has made it illegal to harass whales. Violators face up to $10,000 fines. There's an effort in Hawaii to create a humpback sanctuary in the breeding grounds off the coast of Maui. Much attention is being paid to the protection of the whale, but this comes at a time when, through past slaughter and present neglect, the future of the whale is still in doubt. But one might ask, who really cares? If we can't use them, what difference does it make whether or not whales continue to inhabit the oceans?
As a biologist, it's important to me to care about whales, and I think should be to the rest of us, because they're just another part of the variety of ecosystems that we have. And when you look at an ecosystem and compare it to another one, it turns out that the more complex ones, the ones with the more varied forms of life, are the ones that are more stable and tend to be buffered against disturbances the best. So that's why something like the humpback whale, which is an endangered species, deserves some care, simply for preserving a whole bunch of different kinds of forms of life and not being so short-sighted that we let them pass away without our even trying to be proper stewards.
This Nike missile site is one of the few remaining active Nike Hercules sites in the country. For over 20 years, Nike Hercules missiles were one of the primary thrusts of America's defense system. Their value proven by the fact that they never had to be used for America's defense. Today, the Nike system is almost obsolete, replaced by newer, more sophisticated war weaponry. For years, Alaska has also been one of the cornerstones of U.S. defense. But has Alaska's strategic role, like the Nike missile, changed with the technological advances of global war strategy? A look at Alaska's military importance, next on Alaska Review.